this is always dangerous, but somebody out there have something that's happened in their life this week that you can say that was God working and God was faithful. Anybody raise your hand? Praise God. I see people who have been ill that are back. I've seen people that have been in the face of huge tasks and have been able to get those accomplished. And we see people that have come into this room today for the first time. And we want to say welcome again. We think that that's God's faithfulness to us by your presence here today. Be seated, please. Scripture tells us that every good and perfect gift comes down from the Father above. Listen as our choir leads us in the new doxology.
We're going to pray with the Puritans this morning. Puritan prayer that I love dearly. It's called Resting on God. So let's go to the Lord and pray. O God, most high, most glorious, the thought of your infinite serenity cheers me. For I am toiling and moiling, troubled and distressed, but you are forever at perfect peace. Your designs cause no fear or care of unfulfillment. They stand fast as the eternal hills. Your power knows no bond, your goodness no stint. You bring order out of confusion, and my defeats are your victories. The Lord God omnipotent reigns. I come to you as a sinner with cares and sorrows to leave every concern entirely to you, every sin calling for Christ's precious blood. Revive deep spirituality in my heart. Let me live near to the great shepherd, hear his voice, know its tones, follow its calls. Keep me from deception by causing me to abide in the truth, from harm by helping me to walk in the power of the Spirit. Give me intenser faith in the eternal verities, burning into me by experience the things I know. Let me never be ashamed of the truth of the gospel, that I may bear its reproach, vindicate it, see Jesus as its essence, know in it the power of your Spirit. Lord, help me, for I am often lukewarm and chill. Unbelief mars my confidence. Sin makes me forget you. Let the weeds that grow in my soul be cut at their roots. Grant me to know that I truly live only when I live to you, that all else is trifling. Your presence alone can make me holy, devout, strong, and happy. Abide in me, gracious God. Father, as these words were written and recorded and said centuries ago, we echo them entirely. God, help us to abide in you, to make our homes in you. That Christ would radiate from every fiber of our being, that our pride would die. Our desire for sin would be killed. That we would go to the cross and say, Lord, help us because we have nothing else on this side of eternity to stake our hope on. May the truth of Jesus Christ permeate our being so that every single person in here right now would be confident in the truth of the gospel. That Christ has come, Christ has died, and Christ will come again. Those simple words change everything. And so right now, for those in here who are not in a good place, would you be a balm to their soul? Help them to know that they are loved beyond their wildest imagination. Help them to know that there is a room, a seat for them at God's table, that he wants them there. For those of us who come in here today heavy laden with guilt, God, would you bear our shame? Help us to know that you have borne that on the cross and resurrected us to new life, that we would not live in defeat but live in victory. For those in here lukewarm and not sure if they want to be near to you, God, would you give them a spark, a passion? Help them to see how beautiful life is with you. For those that are physically hurting, would you be near to them? Help them to know that your grace is sufficient for them and give them physical comfort. We pray with all expedience, God, that you would remove their physical ills, that you would heal them so that they would know you and the power that you have. We come in here, God, from 100 different backgrounds or more, different experiences, but our need is the same, and our need is to know the light and to walk in the light and to have the confidence that comes with that. So where we have fallen short, God, would you be near to us? We pray for our world right now, God, that is in turmoil, that there is so much that seems wrong. We pray for the nation of Israel right now. We pray that you would end war at all. We know that Jesus says there will always be war, but we pray, God, that you would end this one. We pray that you would give them strength and hope, and may somehow this be used in your kingdom for your glory. We pray, God, for ongoing conflict around the globe that complicates life for everybody and ends life all too soon. And we pray that your kingdom would get a foothold in those places, and that believers would be salt and light where there is much hurting. We pray for our government. We pray that they would make wise decisions. We lift our hands so that we can live quiet, godly lives, dignified in every way. Thank you, God, for the joy of knowing you. Thank you that we get to be participants in the mystery of faith that is the Christian story. And we ask these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Let's all stand. I think there was a line in that prayer that said, Lord, you take my defeats and make them into your victory. It takes me back to the scripture that says anything we do in our own strength is a stench in our Lord's nostrils. So anything that we can do apart from the Lord on our own is a defeat. But if you've been saved, if you're a child of the King, live with this assurance that the chains of sin and death and hell ultimately is completely gone. You've been set free. And if you're a child of the King and you're living in defeat of something you may have done, cast that off. Jesus died for that on the cross. And if you're his child, we did it a couple weeks ago. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from how much unrighteousness? All his righteousness. Sing these words with me.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. 'Twas blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught child.
nice to know that we are forever His? His word tells us that nothing, nothing can snatch us out of His hand. Can I have an amen for that? Let's pray together. Lord, we thank You that Your word tells us that when we are Yours, we are Yours. And Lord, that if we confess our sins, You are faithful and just to forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And that's yesterday's, today's, and tomorrow's. Lord, let us live in the victory that is Yours, and not live in our past. Let us look forward to the day when we can commune with You in holy perfection, the way You created it in the beginning. But between now and then, Lord, let us try. Let us try to live a life that honors You in everything we do. Right, everyone? Lord, we pray now that as Your word is open, that You would speak through Brother Carter through the power of the Holy Spirit. And we pray all this in the saving name of our Lord Jesus. Amen. Be seated, please.
If you get your Bibles, you can open up to 1 John. We'll continue in this study. I'm wearing maroon today in honor of our Hardin County Tigers. I'm a proud pastor. We have such good representation across the board. Our girls' soccer team has been playing well. Molly Pierce is a district champion in golf. The band show is getting better every week. The Tigers are 8-0 with a big win over Haywood. Apologies if you're from Haywood. either way, it's proud of our students and their work and their effort. All right, so 1 John 2, we have been talking about this assurance from God, this blessed assurance, this confidence that comes when you walk in the light. And so I think it's the pressing issue of our day is not this idea between belief and unbelief. It's not some social or cultural issue, though those are important. I think the biggest issue and the thing that scares Satan the most is a whole bunch of people in God's kingdom who are head over heels confident and certain that Jesus is Lord of their lives, and that their future is set in stone by the gospel, and that they are confident in that, and so they live different lives because of that. I think that scares Satan to death to know that, man, those people, I can't shake them. I'll throw some sickness at them. No, they seem to praise God in that. I'll throw some cultural turmoil at them. God, they cling even tighter to Jesus. I'll try to throw shame at them. Oh, man, they just glorified Jesus and His work in their lives. I think it terrifies Satan that a bunch of people would have that much confidence in Jesus. And that's what John knew too, and that's what he's writing to this church, because there were false teachers who wanted to shake that confidence. They wanted to say, hey, these beliefs you have, these ethics that you're supposed to live out, the way you're supposed to be, I don't know if that's actually what Jesus really wanted. Maybe He said it, maybe He didn't. And so confusion at that level leads to wrong living and wrong belief. And so John says, I don't want you guys to be confused about this. I don't want you to lack confidence on what's real in the world and what's not. So he addresses this false teaching to combat false living. And so we got to the point last week that we talked about God as light a couple of weeks ago and how important that is, that everything good about life, everything stable, every good and perfect gift comes from above, as Richard just said. Like, everything good in life has its genesis in God. And so that is true. And so when we say God is light, what we're trying to connect to there is that the power source of everything enjoyable about life is found in God. And the way you get to that, the way you understand that light, John got to last week, and he says he is the propitiation for our sins. And that is a big churchy word that you have to know. It's on the final exam. Has Jesus fully atoned for our sin? Has everything we have done wrong in the world, every transgression that we have committed, has that been made right by Jesus? And the answer is yes. The answer is a resounding yes, that he has paid it all, and all to him we owe. And so that's got to be your entry point, because if we go the rest of this sermon and you do not have that foundation, this is going to become some sort of hypocritical mumbo jumbo. So you got to know that Jesus and his death and resurrection on my behalf is what changes everything. That's the starting point for us. We're going to get into this, and so we'll see, how will you know you're a Christian? One of the biggest questions I get sometimes is, I'm not sure if I'm a Christian or not. How do you know? I had a professor in college, and it was one of his first jobs. He wore cargo shorts and flip-flops, and I thought that was extreme. I'd never seen a teacher do that before. But I liked him a lot, and we had some interaction and ran into each other a few times in the cafeteria. And so I one time asked him, I said, why do you not give exams? I was a freshman, you know, my whole life. You take a test, right? Standardized testing. I know it's fall break, so I don't want to scare any teachers. But this was my first class I had. There's no tests. And I said, why don't you give tests? And I just remember him saying something like this: my job is just to teach you, and your job is to learn. I was like, you're paying to be here, so it doesn't matter to me if you fail or not. All I can control is my end of that. He said, furthermore, it's just obvious to me who's going to pass the class or not. And I remember he said something like, it doesn't matter to me if you can memorize some facts and write those down on a piece of paper. He said, by the way you come to class, you do the assignments, you turn in the papers, you do the work, I can tell how much work you've put into this. He's like, it's pretty easy to know who passes and who fails. Well, in the same way, John's going to speak to all of us, and he's going to tell us, you'll pass the test of Christianity, not because of your church attendance, and not because of how well you know the lyrics to the hymns, but in how you obey Jesus. Like, that is the evidence. If you've done the work of being a Christian, which, by the way, the work is to have faith in Jesus. He's done the work. But if you're going to pass the test, it's going to come out in how you live your life, your obedience. How do I know that I'm really a Christian? Am I marked by obedience and love? Is the simple response. People oftentimes, when they ask that question, what they're really asking is, am I going to heaven? That's what people want to know. Am I going to heaven? But the sad part is, and it's a limited view of Christianity. Like, yes, absolutely, you become a Christian, you get to go to heaven. That's a wonderful part of it. You don't have to experience the righteous punishment that we deserve. But that's not all it is. It is a total state of being. It's a change in who you fundamentally are, and that starts here and now. And so you're shortchanging yourself if Christianity is just, I get to go to heaven. The joy of being a Christian is that you get to start heaven here and now in this life. Like, that is the true joy. And so it's not just a change of address when you die, but it's a change of heart and life here and now. So the main idea of the message today, the depth of our faith is revealed through our behavior. Two simple ways you can know if you are a believer. And it's not that complicated, but again, it's absolutely vital that you remember Jesus is your atonement. If you work at these tests without acknowledging them through Christ's atonement, you're going to end up just memorizing answers and putting them on a test. You may not actually know that information. You're going to end up a hypocrite and a liar. It's not my words, those are John's, by the way. So that's the key here. You have to walk the Christian faith by grace through faith. And that's it. Like, you can live these tests out precisely because you know Jesus has won your eternal place in heaven. So you are not living these out here and now out of fear that Jesus is going to leave you, or out of fear that God won't love you enough if you don't pass the tests. Like, that is not why you live these out. You live these out because of the adoration for what Christ has done for you, that what he sacrificed for you and for me. That's why we live life the way we do. So if you have your Bible, turn with me. We're in 1 John. We're going to read chapter 2, starting in verse 3. And by this we know that we have come to know him if we keep his commandments. Whoever says, I know him, but does not keep his commandments is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whoever keeps his word in him, truly the love of God is perfected. By this we may know that we are in him. Whoever says he abides in him ought to walk in the same way in which he walked. Beloved, I'm writing you no new commandment, but an old commandment that you had from the beginning. The old commandment is the word that you have heard. At the same time, it is a new commandment that I'm writing to you, which is true in him and in you, because the darkness is passing away and the true light is already shining. Whoever says he is in the light and hates his brother is still in darkness. Whoever loves his brother abides in the light, and in him there is no cause for stumbling. But whoever hates his brother is in the darkness and walks in the darkness and does not know where he is going, because the darkness has blinded his eyes. The word of the Lord. So the first of these examinations would be, do you have the joy of obedience? If you want to know and have confidence in your Christian faith, and you want to know if you truly are a believer, there's kind of two exams to take. And the first is, do you have the joy of obedience? So John starts this out and he says, by this we know that we have come to know him. Two no's there he throws out there. He's giving you double certainty. Not just knowledge of God, but confidence that you have the knowledge of God. Anybody can know God. Demons know God. Judas knew who God was, right? Satan knows God. Caiaphas knew Jesus. But I dare say none of them truly know him how we do. Do you know him experientially? Do you know him subjectively? Do you know how good and true he is? Because John has already drilled down that, hey, look, I saw this guy, right? He starts it out. He says, that which we have seen with our eyes, we have felt him, we have touched him. John tells us in his gospel, I used to lay down next to him at the dinner table. They didn't have chairs. They laid down at the dinner table. And he talks about how John reclines back into Jesus. I just picture John kind of rolling over and looking up at him. Like, it's a funny picture for us. But he says that I know him. Objectively, you cannot deny that. A person named Jesus Christ lived and died. The question is, did he resurrect? And John is telling us, absolutely he did. I saw him after he did. I ate fish with him after he resurrected. I know this Jesus. Objectively, that's undeniable. But subjectively, do you really, really know him? In our English language, we really just have one word for know. And you can know things in different capacities. You can know people. You can know facts. And the beauty of romantic languages is that there's oftentimes more developed language for this. And so in Spanish, anybody in here know how to speak Spanish? I'm not raising my hand, you can see. You think about, there's two words for knowledge in the Spanish language, at least that I know of. Now, I did have remedial Spanish, but I checked this out beforehand, and I'm told this is correct. So in Spanish, the first word for knowledge is saber, right? Saber. And so if you've ever heard someone speak Spanish, they might say something like, or I would say, no sé hablar español, which means I do not know how to speak Spanish. And you use this in regards to facts and dates and black and white knowledge like that. But there's another word for know, which is conocer. And you say conocer when you talk about a person that you know. And so I would say, conozco a Amber Carroll. I know Amber. I know my wife. And you see, there's a difference there. There's a difference. One is facts and information. The other one is subjective knowledge of a person. All of us know who George Washington is. None of us know George Washington. And if you do, show me your time machine, right? You and I don't know people like that have died. But we know people in our everyday existence. You know your family. You know your friends. And so plenty of people know the facts about God. And that's what the false teaching was surrounded upon, was this false teaching that John is addressing here. Is that people say, oh, yeah, that guy, he's good. Yeah, he had this, 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 and this. And he may have meant this by that, and he may not have meant that. And did he really rise from the dead? And if he did, was he a body or was he just a spirit? And so they know all the facts, and they use the facts to cloud everything. Knowledge itself does not save, but the knowledge of the knowledge is what is the joy of Christianity. Plenty of people know the facts about my grandmother's caramel tea cake recipe. You can find it. It's printed on tea towels all over this town, right? Very few people know what they taste like anymore. It is like fallen out of my memory, and no one can recreate them. That is lost, and in the new kingdom, she will make them again. I'm positive of it. I don't know if that's sacrilegious to say, but we'll feast, and we will, I don't know if the marriage supper of the Lamb is a potluck, but if it is, Geraldine Atkinson's bringing caramel tea cakes. Get in line. I'm first. John says that you can know things. You can know subjectively, experientially, who this Jesus is and have confidence in that salvation. And how can you know that? Well, you know that by how you obey, how you live. In verse 4, if you know Jesus, he says the habit of your life, how you walk with Jesus and make him a part of your existence, that reveals if you truly believe him or not. John is telling us that the joy of Christian living is not possible for someone who isn't living and walking how Jesus lived and walked. Not because they aren't living the right way, but because they don't really know Jesus like they say they do. Anybody remember the Brady Bunch episode, Fender Benders? I'm not really a Brady Bunch fan, but I have this weird memory of watching Nick at Night when I was a kid, and I remember this episode where Mr. Duggan, he comes over, he's a neighbor, they have a fender bender in the parking lot, and he says it's Carol because she's a woman driver, right? And Mike Brady, of course, sticks up for his wife. He's defending her honor. Anyway, long story short, they go to court, and he's wearing this neck brace, and it's just ridiculous that he's wearing this neck brace. And he says, oh, I can't move. I'm in so much pain. And Mike has this bright idea where he throws a briefcase down on the ground. And when it smacks the ground, Mr. Duggan jerks his head around and looks at it, and the judge sees him and says, well, I can't trust your testimony, so you lose the lawsuit. That's essentially what John is saying here. If this is truly real in your life, your actions will back it up. But if this is fraudulent in your life, that will be revealed in your lack of obedience to God. If the fruit is bad, the tree is sick. And a confession of Christ means squat if there is no good fruit, no evidence to back that up. He calls that type of person a liar. And that's not cruel on John's part, that's honest. And it probably makes us a little uncomfortable because we know the sins that we have committed in life. You know the sins that you've done this past week. I do too. So remember two things. Propitiation. That's why you got to cling to this reality that Jesus is your atonement. You're not going to lose your salvation because of some sin, because it's modified when he says this is how you walk, the habit of your life. Remember what we said last week? Christians are not people who don't sin. It's just when they do, they hate their sin and they don't want to do it anymore. They take it to the cross. So this is walk as Jesus walked. If you are a Christian, your life will begin to look more like Jesus, like Father, like Son. A whole lot of times I hear this question, I mentioned this last week, is this okay? Is this a sin to do this? And I just think that's the starting point of a wrong question. That like the true question is, does this honor my Savior who loved me and gave himself for me? You know, everything in my life, I can't go back and say, oh, my parents said, no, don't do this, I should do this. Like they didn't prepare me for every scenario I would ever face in life. But they trained me with values and with principles that when I have gotten to places in life, I can think, oh, my parents wouldn't want me to do this. My parents wouldn't like it if I did this. In the same way, if you truly know God and know Jesus as your Savior, and the closer you get to him, you'll just know those things in life. Now, absolutely, we need to know the scriptures and know what it says is good and evil, like 100%. But I just have this real strong belief that if you understand the depth of Christ's propitiation on your behalf, and you understand the depth of your sin, then when you get in those situations, you'll realize, my perfect, righteous Christ would not want me to partake in this. Or you get an urge, a push, and you say, I need to do this because my Savior would like for me to do this. The more you know of your Savior, the more you will have that wisdom in your daily life. Walk as Jesus walked. And so what do you get if you walk like Jesus Christ the righteous and know Jesus Christ the righteous? John tells us that his love is perfected in you. Now, I don't 100% know what that means, and I think that's not, in preaching class, you're not supposed to say stuff like that, but I don't 100% know what it means that God's love is perfected in us on this side of eternity. But what it seems to be intimating here is that as you continue to obey God and draw closer and closer and closer to him, that your confidence and your knowledge, subjective knowledge of God's love for you grows every step of the way. That you've got certainty that this faith is real and that it can, you can bank on it. It will carry you through the hard times and the good times, in the valley and on the mountaintop. You feel God's love being perfected in your life. And so how do you have that faith? It comes through Christ's atonement, and it's revealed in how you live. That's the joy of living as a Christian. I heard just a story this week about a believer that I admire. And this man has a huge faith in God, and it's evidenced in his life. And the story went that he was in a prayer meeting and he was calling down blessings from heaven with a strong voice, and he was getting after it in this prayer meeting. And about that time, he got interrupted by someone who had to ask him about something. And this guy said that he's sitting there and just listening to all these prayers. And then he looks over and he goes, hold on, God, I'll be right back. I got to talk to this guy. And he walks over, talks to the guy, comes back and goes, okay, God, it's me again. He had a confidence that God was just right there listening, that they were in a conversation. It didn't matter that Jesus is in heaven interceding on his behalf. It was as if he was right there in the room with him. That was the strength of his knowledge of God. And so is that how you know him? Is that how confident you are he's right there with you? And I'll say something here to the youth. We'll get this. Do you have the confidence that you can leave God on red and come back to him a minute later? Some of them get that. Do you have the knowledge that God is listening to you and you are listening to him and you are right there with one another? Do you have that certainty in your life? If you do, it's revealed in how obedient you are to him. And the more obedient you are to him, the more confident you become in him. And so it sows to each other. It's a symbiotic relationship, this Christian life of obedience. So, joy of obedience is the first kind of exam we take. The second one, do you have the joy of love? The first test is related to a certainty of ethics. The second one is, how do you love? This test expands upon the issues that he raises in the first part of this chapter. And he says in verse 7, I'm giving you this new commandment. What is this commandment? When we hear the word command, none of us probably have positive thoughts about that word, right? No one wants to be commanded to do anything. And you see how John uses this. This is a command to love. He says it's not a new commandment. This is a very old commandment. But then he says, it's also a new commandment. What's the deal here, John? He's old when he's writing this. Is he confused? I don't know. I don't think so. I think what he means by it is simply this. The heretics around him were teaching that how you live doesn't really matter. And this new way of thinking is better. And so John says, no. Let me go all the way back to the Old Testament. Let me go all the way back to what Jesus says. All of the law and the prophets hang on what? Loving God and loving your neighbor. So that's a summation of the Old Testament. And so if that is the very idea of the whole of the entire Old Testament, then John says this is a very old principle that God wove into creation itself. From the foundation of the world, love has been God's essence. But then he moves beyond that and he says, but it's also a new one. Well, how is it a new one? It is new because of two things that I think are true, at least two, of what Christ says about love. First of all, Christ puts this humongous emphasis on love as the pinnacle of Christian faith. John 13, 34, he says, love one another as I have loved you. How did Jesus love us? Very sacrificially, very costly. It is not an emotional-based love, but it is a duty-bound choice by his word that he gave that he would love us. And so he fulfills this duty, not out of anger or frustration, but for the joy set before him. He knew that the cross is the greatest demonstration of love I could ever do. And so I will go there happily to endure it for the joy set before me. And so Jesus emphasizes that's how you are to love others. And so he emphasizes love over every other virtue, or maybe more nearly what it is that every other virtue flows out of love. And then he says the extent of your love should be incredible. In Matthew 22, the story of the Good Samaritan, it's pretty remarkable how far that man was told to take his love for his neighbor. If you remember it, the gentleman says, how do I inherit eternal life? And he tells him, love your neighbor. Who is my neighbor? Well, he tells him a story. He tells him a story of a man who loved somebody who was not like him, who was different than him. It took him days out of his journey. It cost him a lot of money, and he did it because that is what love is. Sacrificial love, regardless of status or ethnicity or nationality or skin color or religion. He says in this text that the darkness is passing away and the light is shining. Now, Jewish people would have a concept of the age that was and the age that is to come. And Jesus serves as the bridge for those two ages for Christians. Galatians 1:4, describing Jesus, says he gave himself for our sins to deliver us from the present evil age. And so Jesus says, I'm taking you out of the old dark age and I'm bringing you into the new one. And so if you can picture in your head a Venn diagram, we are currently in the middle of that Venn diagram. Jesus gave all these earthly statements, and John loved to write them down for us. He said, I am the light, I am the vine, I am the gate. And those are all heaven realities that are these pictures are given for us to see here and now. And so this light, he tells us, you get to shine in this dark world. A few months ago, I changed out our closet light fixture for an LED. And you get to decide on the LED itself. Okay, do you want cool daylight, warm daylight, right? Brightness, whatever. And so you crank it up all the way, right? In a closet, you want to see where those moths have been eating. But either way, you crank it up and you go and you got to turn the breaker off. At least I do. I'm not as good of an electrician as some of the men in our church. And so you turn the breaker off and you go, you change it out. And then you got to see, well, did I do a good enough wiring job? Did I tape correctly? Did I pass the test of the International Builder's Code? But either way, you go to the breaker, and I actually got my boys involved in this. I opened the window right outside of where that closet would be, and I said, all right, I'm going to turn this breaker on, and you tell me if the light comes on. And so I flicked the breaker, and I just hear silence. I said, did the light come on? And I just hear two little, no! I wasn't connected to the power source. I did not complete the circuit. And so you go and flip the breaker back off. Go back in, right? Check, okay, I see that the wiring came undone. I better tape harder. You go, you flip the breaker back on. The light is on, shining in the darkness. What your love for others shows is, are you connected to the power source? Can you love others in this dark age? And love is your weapon of light for others. Can you do that in an age that is very dark? And the extent of your love will reveal the brightness shining in the midst of a very dark world. Without love, it's obvious that we are disconnected from the power source. And without Christ, we cannot love others rightly. Now, our society loves to talk about love. Loves to idealize love in terms of romance, in terms of good feelings, and being happy and okay with everything. That is not love. God did not love us enough to leave us in our sin, but instead, he became a man who knew no sin so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. He loved us enough to say, you're wrong. You're living incorrectly. You're not doing what you're supposed to be doing. And so love is not just okay with everything and feeling good, but it is an action, a sacrifice that I want your better over mine. That I want to sacrifice on your behalf. Without Christ, we cannot love others rightly. John calls it the opposite of this. You either love through Christ or you hate. There is no middle ground. You either love others because you know Christ's love for you, or you hate others because you don't know Christ's love. There's no picking and choosing here. And so the command is both old and new. It's old because it's found in the very character of God written in the Old Testament for us. It's new because in Christ, as he embodied it, we now see the emphasis and the extent of what love should be. It is our first priority. And this is going to radically shake us. Like, if you're sitting here and you're like, oh yeah, old information, heard 1 John 100 times, like, you're not getting it. Like, you need to evaluate how are you loving, not just in some general sense, but here and now in your life today, how are you loving? Because it should shake us the exact same way it shook first century believers. Pastorally speaking, the news, social media, it wants you to hate. They make money when you hate. And they want you to do that. And it wants you because then you will talk about it and click it and share it, and they will get money off of it. Hate is a big business. And people that know the complexity of the human brain better than you and I do know how to hardwire social media to make you angry. And I promise you, if you think you are immune to it, you are not. You aren't. Facebook has trillions on the line in their company's future to get you furious. You don't think that they are studying your brainwaves and your patterns and how you operate? They know how to anger you. They know how to say, they pick, I'm telling you, they can lay the foundation because they know we can make a lot of money off these people. And so when you go into social media, when you watch the news, just know their very motivation is to get you to respond in anger. Jesus says, no. John tells us, no. That is not the game we play. We are free from that game. You don't have to hate. You can have the beauty and the joy of love. And so it doesn't matter if someone looks differently than us, if they think differently than us, if they vote differently than us. Our call is the same, love. My seminary president, Danny Aiken, says this: if you hate because of face, place, or race, you are in darkness, you are lost, and you are unregenerate. And that's not him talking, that's John. If you hate your brother, you do not walk in the light, but you stumble around in the darkness. We love people who wrong us. We love people who are not like us. We love people because Jesus loved us. If you know the story of the cross and the switchblade of Teen Challenge's origins, you've read this story before, but the man who started it, David Wilkerson, he heard about all this gang violence going on in New York. And in today's day, we hear about cities outside of Savannah that are hard places to live and much wrong goes on there. And what is our temptation? Oh God, who would ever live there, right? Well, David Wilkerson didn't do that. He went to New York. He led street revivals. He preached. He got to know people that were hard to love. He got slapped by a man named Nicky Cruz, a gang leader. And you probably know the quote if you've read the book. And Nicky Cruz tells him, you talk to me about Jesus, I'm going to cut you into 1,000 pieces. And David Wilkerson said, yeah, you could do that. You could cut me up into 1,000 pieces and lay them out on the street. And every single piece will say, I love you. That is powerful because in a dark, dark world, how brightly that shines around us. That's the type of new and old love that Jesus expects from his followers. Loving others is hard, but in the long run, it is much better than hate. Hate is stumbling around in the darkness. You're going to trip and you're going to fall straight into hell. Your life's going to be miserable here and now, and it'll be miserable for eternity. But when you understand Jesus Christ, the righteous one, did not hate you in your sin and did not hate me in my sin, but instead came to earth, lived an existence that he did not need to live, did not count equality with God as something to be held on to, but instead emptied himself and took on flesh, took on the position of a servant. Like when you recognize that that's what he did for you, now you do the same for others. Love will cost you something, but what you get in return is the freedom and confidence of knowing and being known by Christ. And that gives you certainty. That in this day and age, yes, absolutely, things happen and it's irritating. And yes, people will do bad things. And we talked out of Ecclesiastes about what righteous hate may look like or righteous anger. But at the end of the day, we are just like every other person in the world. Sinners before God, we've just been given a Savior. And now we have the chance in a dark world to shine that light for others to see. And there's a confidence that comes with that. Knowing that I don't have to get into a he versus me battle, but instead, when reviled, you do not revile back, but you entrust it to the one who judges justly, just like Jesus did. So, obedience and sacrificial love are not really in vogue today, not at a popular level. Like no one's celebrating people who are very obedient and very loving. You don't pass out achievement patches for those to sew on. And that's okay, because we still live in a dark world, and you and I know, both know that a small light in a dark world still shines. And we have that light, and we have the ability to shine that light by how we love and obey the Lord. And so will you pass the test because Christ has done the work for you? Because if you try to obey and you try to love out of your own power, your well is not deep enough. You're going to go dry fast. I have done it in my life time and time again. And it's at that point you recalibrate and you realize Jesus is the power source. How have I been loved? Look at the obedience of Christ to the Father and how he loved me. And so I need to replicate that. You got to get that part right. You got to get that part right, that you get to obey Jesus. You get to love others like Jesus did. My mentor in college, a guy named Jeff Swanson, love him dearly. I'll never forget. It's like changed my life, this statement. One morning I said, Jeff, we getting together next week? He said, no, my wife is off work next week and I get to have breakfast with her. And that sounds normal to you and me, right? But the way he phrased that, I get to. It was an honor. It was a treat for him. She is the most important thing in my life and I get to have breakfast with her. Not because he was duty bound out of obligation, not because he had signed some marriage license, not because he loved her. Because he knew his wife well and loved the beauty of getting to spend time with her. We get to obey God. We get to love others as Christ has loved us. When my son Walt was born a couple months ago, this church was so good to us. We just started cooking dinner like last week for ourselves. And I've got some newer neighbors, and so they know that I'm a pastor, and we've spoken, you know, several times across the yard, and after a while, they knew we were pregnant as well, and so after he was born, I'm catching up on the baby and telling him how Walt's doing and Amber's doing, and he goes, who are all these cars pulling up? Like, what do you got like 8 cars pulling up every single day. What's going on there? It was very weird to him. And I just told him, man, that's just my church family taking care of us. It's just what we do. That was so strange to him. He said, man, how incredible. That's awesome that you've got that. Yeah, it is. It's awesome that we've got 1 John in our lives. It's awesome that we get to obey God and love others. And it's incredible that that's a huge witness to a dark world around us. It's not common. But then again, the road to Christ is not well traveled. Narrow is the gate. Our call is to walk it in faith because Jesus walked it first for us. I don't know where you are. I don't know what you're going through. I mean, I'll do some of you, but not all of you. But I know this, there's no way to get through the hard things on your own power, and there's no way to rightly appreciate the good things on your own power. You will go awry on either of those. But when you understand what Jesus has done for you and how that changes who you are, then you have a confidence and a peace that everything's going to be okay, and I can start living that way right now. Let's pray. Father, thank you that we get to obey our Creator, not out of burden, but out of joy, because you know best. Your ways are best. Thank you that we get to love others, because in our natural flesh, we will put up walls, but Jesus Christ knocks those down. He has removed the wall of hostility and given us a ministry of reconciliation because we are new creations in Christ. And so I pray right now you would speak to our souls, help us to be in right relationship with you, to walk rightly, to walk the way Jesus walked, to love others well because Jesus first loved us. May we see what Christ has done for us and want to replicate that in the world around us. Speak to us now as we worship you, God. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.